How would you describe your new film, Kavaludaari?
It's a murder mystery, it's a thriller. If you honestly go out there and put good content, there will be people who will come out and watch it. I just want to push myself in terms of my ability to tell stories.
Hello Hemanth, welcome to Film Companion.
Hi.
Hi.
Pleasure to be here.
This, your first film, Godhi Banna Sadharna Mykattu, was a father-son drama. How would you describe your new film, Kavaludaari?
It's a murder mystery, it's a thriller. It's one of my favorite genres. I grew up watching a lot of Hitchcock, and so I've tried to take in elements from these kind of films that I've grown up watching. And it's a police drama, it's a police story. It's about one guy who goes, you know, trying to solve this case. And I've tried to explore the what is similar to Godhi Banna. I've tried to explore the human angle to a police officer, like not the filmy sort of a treatment, but what it really means to be a police officer. So
there is like a bit of noir and a bit of drama. In
yes,
it.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
It's like a homage to noir, but it's a drama.
So if there was one noir film that you wanted to give me as a reference, which would that be?
There are too many. The Orson Welles one, The Third Man.
Third Man.
The Third Man would probably be there.
The closest?
Yeah.
Wow.
So we've tried a lot of shadow play, use of mirrors and the classic elements of,
right,
in terms of contrast, lighting and even music and sound design and stuff like that.
Your first film, like any first film, was a bit under the radar. So now, not only was that a hit, but this one's being presented by Puneet Rajkumar and things like that. Does that create any additional pressure that it's a much more visible kind of film?
Not really. As in, for me, the thing is, I put a lot of pressure on myself. So it's not about the box office. And of course, those things matter because ultimately it's important that it's a place of commerce. It's a business. It's a very expensive art form. So it's my job to make sure that, you know, the producer is in a safe place, but also express my perspective, so to speak. So the pressure is from that perspective, the business side of it as such. But I don't feel any sort of pressure. I just want to push myself in terms of my ability to tell stories.
Till a few years ago, a lot of people on the internet, presumably the class audience, they said things like, you know, I had stopped watching Kannada films in the theaters. And now I'm kind of doing that again. In your opinion, what was it that made them stop going to theaters? Was it that the scripts were bad? What was it?
I have seen it from very close proximity because I come from a family where my dad is crazy about films. Like, I've heard stories from my grandmother where apparently he used to travel to Bangalore, watch the morning matinee, evening, night show, and then take the last bus back to myself. That's how crazy he was about watching films, and it had carried forward. I can sort of remember a time when suddenly that experience stopped, you know, and it was because of the kind of films that were coming out. Primarily, so Bangalore went through a huge real estate boom, and there's a lot of money, like easy money, and that money got pushed into films, and a lot of people got into, you know, films. So quality sort of took a back seat, and I think we marginalized the middle class film watching audience, which had grown up watching classics, you know, like Ambrish or Anand sir or Rajkumar sir, so on and so forth, you know, Vishnuvardhan. So there's a huge section of the society which just stopped coming to the theatres because it was very clear from the very onset, from the poster, from the publicity material, that this film is not for you. You know, this film is for the mass.
Okay.
So I feel they drove that message really, really aggressively and consistently for about 5-6 years, which is when we lost that audience. And slowly and surely they're coming back, and they're very responsive. And in my limited experience, I've made only one film, produced one. So in my limited experience, I have seen that they are so eager to go and watch a good film. So that is a good thing.
And your film is a classic example because it's not what one would say, it's like a mass film or whatever it is, but it did very well in the...
Yeah, yeah. For me, it used to be a matter of great pride that I used to get messages saying, we haven't seen a film in 15 years. My father had stopped seeing Kannada films. I took him to the theater. Those are the kind of, you know, box office and all that aside,
right,
those are the kind of messages that even to this day gives me a lot of strength and gives me a lot of motivation. And it's a matter of pride for me personally.
Would you say Lucia was the film that changed things around? Would you say the Kannada film industry can basically be divided into a pre-Lucia phase and a post-Lucia phase?
I don't think it would be inaccurate to say that. I think what Lucia did was it showed that you can make a film if you have an idea, you know, and technology was just sort of becoming finding its way into filmmaking as such. The negative was, you know, going out of sync. So I think Pawan really started something with Lucia for sure. It gave a lot of people, like, I remember, because we all started out at the same time, and when Pawan went and made Lucia, what was clear is if you're mad enough and if you're crazy enough, you can go and make a film. I think that was a very strong message. I think most definitely it empowered a lot of people to go ahead and make their film. So I think credit is to Pawan for doing something like that. And it usually is the case. The thing is, after he did that, Rakshit did Ulidhaaru Kandanthe. Not that Rakshit followed Pawan, or it is not, you know, it's not like a chain reaction, but it sort of gives a sense that, okay, that film worked, you know, this film might also work. So people become a little more daring, become a little more crazy about their dreams and aspirations. So that's always a nice thing.
In your TED talk, The Process of Change, I watched that. Why are you laughing?
No, I mean, it was a pretty painful long talk. So I feel bad for you that you had to sit and watch it.
It was a very interesting talk. You said that you used to watch a lot of films, but you used to choose really bad films to watch. I mean, at least from the talk, you said that you used to seek out the posters that looked like the shittiest films and then kind of go and watch them. One, why? And two, what did that teach you?
The thing is, I used to watch every film because I was trying really hard to make it in the film industry, and I wanted to understand. I had a sense of pride and a sense of arrogance, which I used to feel good about watching those films. Somehow I used to sit in the theater, watch these films, and feel like I am a better filmmaker.
Right.
And that sense of arrogance over a period of time, I realized was limiting me from going out and making my film. I was busy keeping myself occupied, you know, criticizing, and it was not constructive. And it was basically, it was just for entertainment more than anything. I just love watching films, whatever, you know, good, bad, ugly. So I was watching it primarily for that, to understand what is working with the audience and to get a sense of what is the mindset of these filmmakers who are making these films. What is the idea? Where is it getting lost? And so it was more like a market research sort of a thing. And over a period of time, it helped me understand that everybody is trying to make their story, you know. So I have to just concentrate on going and making my story. It doesn't matter if somebody has made their story, you know, imperfectly. For lack of a better word, what matters is how you and how eager you are to go out and make your story. So that was my biggest learning
from the bad films.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is a question that I would ask you. I would ask Rakshit if I met him, Prashant, Neil. Now, there have always been, every industry gets new talent. Every industry goes through a new generation of directors. There is always, they are called this generation or this batch, you know, kind of a thing. But with this particular batch or generation that you call it, that is you with Rakshit Chetty, with Prashant Neel, with Pawan Kumar, all these people, there is a sense that there is something different. Maybe there's a little more cinephilia, maybe the things like the shot taking and all that is a little more international. You know, how would you classify this generation compared to earlier generations? I'm not asking you to say which one is good or bad.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, like, in terms of what they represented versus how, you know, you are.
I think because the world is becoming like a smaller place and you have people watching Netflix on their mobile phones, I think it's a very natural consequence that you are finding young filmmakers today wanting to do something that they saw in a film that was made in Germany, you know. So it's more accessible for us. So in that sense, for us filmmakers, for us young filmmakers, so to speak, the journey in terms of the reference point of what is the quality out there is something that we are very aware. Like, it's very difficult for us to put something out in comparison to what already exists. So we have to up our game, you know, in terms of, it's not necessarily that somebody took a shot like this or somebody choreographed a scene like this and we have to do the same. It's just that there is a sense of quality that exists out there, right, in the internet. And today, YouTube videos are being done so professionally, and so, you know, some videos are fantastic. You can watch it like multiple times over. Mm. So you have to, you know, bring your A game when you're making your film. So I think that is what has made things a lot more interesting.
That's what characterizes your...
Yeah. So it doesn't, like you said, it doesn't necessarily mean we're making better films.
Yeah.
It's just that we are trying to lift the sense of quality that exists, at least perceived quality that exists.
So like me, you did your engineering and you did a bit of journalism as well. Mm. And then you jumped into filmmaking. What made that happen? Is there like one movie that made you say, listen, that's what I want to do the rest of my life?
So I've always identified myself as a writer. Even when I was doing engineering, I used to scribble in class, like random things, very emo type of stuff. And so I used to think, what would it be like? This is pre-internet,
right,
the era before internet. So the world was still, it wasn't a world of possibilities. It was still like, what will you do? You know, you will write and do what? You know, these are the kind of questions that you get from family. And although my family has been very supportive, but you have that internal voice inside your head that's asking you, really, are you serious? Do you want to write and do what? So those are the kind of things that, you know, was bothering me. And I kept wanting to write. I was pretty clear about that. Then slowly that led to writing stories, and I read a lot. So it sort of became an extension. And then one of the first films that sort of had a major influence on me was when I saw, there's a place in Bangalore called Shushitra Film Society where just people just screen really, really beautiful films for dirt cheap. Like for 200 bucks, you can go watch like 10, 20 films in a month. I happened to be one of those people, and I saw a series on Truffaut. I saw 400 Blows and the entire Antoine Donnell series. And when I saw that, I was, the something about the film, it didn't feel like a film, firstly, because I was used to a certain kind of cinema.
How old were you?
I'd just gotten out of engineering.
Okay.
I was fairly old in that sense, but maturity-wise, I think I was just, you know, getting into that stage where I was understanding concepts of life and future and aspiration, dreams and so on. So when I saw this film, it's about a boy struggling with ideas, and so it really sort of resonated with me. And I was like, films can be such a powerful medium, you know. And those films stayed with me for a while. And that's when I was like, and I've always been interested in music. Although I'm tone deaf, I can't play a note, but I love music. Like, I have to listen to music. So it, for me, the whole visual and audio sort of marriage made perfect sense. That's how I like decided, okay, you know, I'm going to try making films. Started fooling around with a camcorder and stuff like that.
So in a way, the so-called Kannada new wave, which you represent, began with the French new wave.
Yeah, possibly. Yeah, actually, come to think of it.
You began by assisting Girish Kasaravalli in Gulabi Talkies. And he's one of the names, the few names in Kannada cinema at that point that actually traveled around outside of Karnataka. What did you learn from him, one? And two, would you say, based on Godhi Banna, that something of his signatures have stayed with you?
I learned a lot from sir, in the sense that I couldn't go to a film school.
Right.
I wanted to, but I was very scared because I was never good in academics. I didn't want to go to film school because I was scared that I'll screw that up, you know, because I'd screwed up every other institutional education, so to speak.
Right.
So I was like, okay, I'll learn on the job. So when I went to sir, he was like my film school. So there are a lot of things that I didn't understand when he was doing what he was doing. And 6 months later, when I used to, like when I saw the film, I was like, oh, this is why he shot this scene this particular way. And you know, it was not like a very broken down structural learning as such, but it was very, like it was just like a tap of water, and it's about how I absorb that. And in terms of Godhi Banna, in terms of what I've tried to learn from him, is that it's important that you have your footprint as a storyteller. Your perspective, what you're trying to say, and how you use the visual medium is very, very important. Like the movement of camera, the usage of camera. Those are all things that I sort of got a clear understanding of while working with sir. And it helped me understand what you can do with very little. Because Gulabi Talkies, we made a, like there are scenes in the film, when I see it now, I cannot believe it was shot in the way it was shot. The fish market was literally, there were four assistant directors who were running around asking people who are getting down from a bus if they can hang around for 5 minutes. And in that 5 minutes, Kasaravalli sir used to finish his shots. And we were like, what is he doing? And it was all on a low base. So it was from the perspective of the feet. The character was sitting down. So the passage of people walking across created the sense of a crowd. There were literally 10 people. So when I saw this on film, I was like, wow, you know, if you know your craft, you can really do wonders. And another interesting thing about sir was, we didn't have a monitor. It was again pre-digital. We shot on 16mm. So he used to sit on one chair, the cinematographer, Ramchandra. I used to be holding a property. Kasaravalli sir used to say, little to the right, little to the right, keep it there. I'd be like, how is this man sitting some, you know, 30 feet away from the camera telling me if that is in frame? And Ramchandra sir never used to allow me to see through the viewfinder because it's taboo. Like cinematographers, you know how they are. So when he used to go out for a smoke, I used to ask the assistant if I can peep through the viewfinder. I used to peep. And if this is the frame, the placement of the said property would be right like 1 inch into the frame. That was his grip on the medium. So I understood that, you know, that is so crucial. The art of the craft that is required for storytelling. I learned that a lot from sir.
I was surprised to see your name pop up in the list of writers for Andhadhun. How did that happen? And can you talk about a scene that you helped to shape? I mean, I know it's a collaborative thing, but yeah. One scene more than the others that...
So the thing is, I was a little frustrated with how things were going in Bangalore around 2016, 2017. I was really like watching like a copious amount of bad films and generally very frustrated.
That's generally a method of coping.
Yeah, I was watching everything I could. So I was really frustrated. At some point of time, I decided, you know, I'm wasting my time. I'm not honing my skills. I'm not learning the craft. So I need to challenge myself. So I decided I'll try my luck and go to Bombay. One good thing that worked in Bombay is the moment that I said I have assisted Kasaravalli sir, the kind of regard and respect and appreciation that I got was something that was missing here. If I went and told somebody here that I'd assisted Kasaravalli, the reaction was like, yeah, he's an art filmmaker, you know. That used to be like, it used to bother me a lot, but in Bombay it was the opposite. So I happened to meet Sriram Raghavan and we sort of just, you know, jammed and I presented ideas and it sort of went cold. I came back. He was doing one of those yearly script writing sessions in IIT Chennai. I reached out to him and I said, I have an idea. And in fact, I presented him the idea of Kavaludaari back then. And he read the synopsis and he really liked it. He said, this is very interesting. Let's work on something together. So we exchanged mails, kept sending him ideas, and somehow it wasn't working. I just happened to come across this short film and I thought it was brilliant, and you know, the French short film. So I sent it to him immediately, and I think it was around 12 in the night. He saw it and he immediately called me. He's like, this is fab, you know, this is kick-ass, let's do this. I was very excited, and that's how we started working on it.
So in a way, you originated the project.
Yeah, in the sense.
Because you sent the film and sent it.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. So from that point on, we just started working, sending. We have exchanged like many, many emails. I worked primarily on the first half. After a point, the film wasn't, we were not able to crack the third act in terms of figuring out at least in which direction the film can go. And I also got an opportunity to make my film.
Right.
So, and he was also dabbling with a couple of other ideas at that point. So it just sort of went on the back burner and we left. To come back to the piece that I worked on, the whole, the police officer being the girlfriend, I mean, Tabu's secret lover, so to speak. Yeah. The entire first half is basically, which is where I majorly contributed. I had in fact nothing to do with the second half. In fact, I think all due credit should be given to the writers who have actually written the whole film. But my work was primarily with the first half. And with regard to how, like the old lady who peeps from the, across the hall. So these are all things that, you know, that I had found interesting. And the cat, these are all things that we had, these are all things that came up when we were jamming together.
You said in an interview that we face severe competition from other language films, the highest any state in India faces. In this kind of situation in Bangalore, how do you ensure that a film of yours doesn't get lost?
Ultimately, it comes down to storytelling. Like, the good thing about cinema is the richest guy in the world with the best equipment can go and make a film. The poorest guy in the world with a great idea can go and make a film. And success is not assured. When I mean success, it doesn't mean box office. Right. I mean how you connect. It's art at the end of it. So a costly crayon is not going to ensure a better painting or a better drawing. So it's about content. And I think if you honestly go out there and put good content, there will be people who will come out and watch it. What you need to know as a filmmaker, and I think it's a prerequisite, is that you understand the business, you understand the market. You can't make a very, very costly a film knowing very well that only 200 people are going to watch it.
Right.
You know, you can't make a niche piece. So if you're going to make a niche piece, then your budget will have to support that piece. So it the maths has to make sense. So I think there is space for us. There is a fear that internally that all of us in Kannada, I mean, I speak for most people when I say this, that we tend to get lost. Because it irks me and pains me when I say this, but we have to see and check the calendar to see if a Tamil film is releasing,
right,
if a Telugu film is releasing. It bothers me, but the thing is, it's you know, it's the free market. I believe in a free market. Everybody should have a right.
Right.
Otherwise, we'll have a very fundamental sort of a attitude where we shun other language films. I don't believe in that. I believe there are people, hence films are being presented. It's not like, you know, there is no dearth of demand. So, but provisions have to be made, at least in terms of exhibiting the film. We have very few theatres exclusively for Kannada. I think those kind of things, actions need to be taken with regard to that.
But the average audience in the cities, let's say, because I ask this because your films are primarily urban.
Correct.
Right. They might travel, but I'm saying there's a certain sensibility that might make them work better in the cities than in the interiors. So when you have a situation like that, let's say you're releasing, planning a release on a Friday, and let's say there's a Shah Rukh or Salman film coming that day, and there's a Vijay or Rajit film coming that day, or something like that. With the average, let's say Bangalore, with the average Bangalorean, which film do you think that they would it depend on the language, their own language, or would you, what I'm trying to ask is, would the average Kannadiga still come to watch a movie?
Definitely. So there is a very strong dedicated fan base for Kannada films, who will watch only Kannada films. There's also the thing about Kannada culturally, if you look at it, historically also, you have, it's like a mini India in the sense that you have a lot of Tamilians who migrated and who stayed there. They're actually Kannadigas. Their sensibility is Kannadigas. When they speak, they're no less Kannadiga than I am. It's just that they also speak another language at home.
Right.
So they will also watch another film.
Right.
So given a choice between a mediocre film and a headlining act, they will go for the headlining act. You know, so you need to be able to draw them as well. There it gets challenging because that population of people who speak dual languages is very high in Karnataka. So I think that is where the biggest challenge is. But I think with interesting content, we are able to get, you know, that audience to come in as well.
Okay.
So it's happening.
So as a person from the Kannada film industry, while growing up, how did you see this film from other languages? What are some of the things that you liked and disliked about the Telugu, Kannada and Malayalam films? Let's just talk about the South.
I watched a lot of Tamil films because of my dad. He loves film. So he used to watch a lot of Tamil films, a lot of Kamal Haasan films, a lot of Mani Sir's films. So, Monoragam, these are all films that when I saw it, like I couldn't understand, but there was such raw emotion in the visuals that it was saying something, you know. So, I've had strong influence of watching Tamil films, very less of Telugu, because my mother and my dad, they weren't too action friendly, and Telugu films generally had a very, you know, very heavy in terms of action. So my exposure to Telugu films have been very minimal. Only much later in life, when I wanted to sort of understand what's happening across the border, is when I started watching Telugu films. And there are some films which I have seen 15 times, 16 times. Like Attudu is a film that I've seen 16 times because I just love the film. You know, it's like you take a commercial film and you reinvent it.
Right.
In that sense. It was very fresh for me when I watched it. I was like, wow, you can make a commercial film like this. So there are films that I've seen, but Telugu is very minimal. I watched a lot of Malayalam films off late again, because I feel in terms of sensibilities, one interesting thing, I mean, to go off on a tangent, I started going to the Kerala Film Festival every year. It became like a part of my calendar in the time that I was, struggling to make my own film or understanding cinema or in the process. There I started noticing that a film by Adur Gopalakrishnan, his film had posters on the walls, like how we have, you know, films of pop, like commercial film posters. And I noticed when I generally inquired around, people were going to these films with, like, in a huge crowd. I was like, wow, what is this? You know, it's so strange. And then there's this interesting thing that happened when I was going in an auto from one theater to another. And one of the auto drivers turned around and said, don't go to that theater, that film is not nice. I was going to watch a Russian film. And he's telling me that it's not nice. And he told me, watch this Spanish film, it's very nice. I'm like, what is this place? What, these people, what, they don't do anything else. They sit and watch cinema or what? I was fascinated. So my interest in Malayalam films is primarily because of the people and their love for cinema.
Right.
So that I've seen a lot of Malayalam films because of that.
You mentioned this earlier that you didn't go to film school, Pawan didn't go to film school, Rakshit didn't go to film school, but you're all successful. So when, if today, like a young kid who wants to do films comes and asks you a question, sir, should I go to film school or not? What would you tell that kid?
Absolutely. I mean, I'd say go for it if you can afford it. There are some film schools which are, the price tag and what you learn doesn't make sense, especially in today's world where technology is so, like, you can do so much with your mobile phone and the internet is, you know, your biggest tool. You don't really have to spend that kind of money to learn filmmaking. But what film school does, which I desperately craved for and still crave for, is a sense of structure, you know, a sense of discipline. It helps you understand the process. There is a method to the madness. I think all of us in our own way have figured out our respective method for our particular, you know, madness. So it's, I think, important to have that structure, especially if you are a newbie and if you want to get into the process of understanding the craft of filmmaking. I think it's important to know that structure. So I would definitely say go for it, but also be, you know, there are a lot of con jobs where people, you know, there are film schools which just charge way too much. So I'd ask them to be a little picky.
So when it comes to film schools, you know, let me take the example of engineering, right? The theory that you learn through books, you find that when you actually go out to a plant or something like that, it's totally different, you know. Mm-hmm. Do you think that that could be the way in film school as well, that you learn so much theory that sometimes you have to literally unlearn it on the job?
Correct. It tends to happen in the sense that, like, for example, it's a very classic thing. If you pick a certain era of cinematographers in Indian cinema, if you look at the way they light the night scenes, there's a tinge of blue.
Blue, yeah.
Like all of them.
Yeah.
And it's something that is sort of passed down to them. If you look at their assistants who have worked and who have accomplished and have become cinematographers today, if you see the way they light, it's the same. So for me, when I see a night scene, if I see blue, it irritates me.
Yeah. Right?
Because it is not that it is wrong, it is that it is being forced down somebody's throat. Like the whole idea of figuring it out for yourself, you run the risk of that. You run the risk of things being told, you know, to you that this is the way. So I think it is about being in a place where you question everything. I think that's very important for an artist, that's very important for a filmmaker, to constantly reevaluate and understand where you are at. What is it that you are observing? Do you really need this? What is your take on it? I think that introspection cycle is something that should be a constant for filmmakers. As long as you have that, then you can survive anywhere, literally. So, but a lot of times when you have structured learning, when you have educational institutions, that sort of takes a backseat.
Hemanth, you worked for a year and a half on what you later called a safe film about a boy with commitment issues. And later you discarded that film. It didn't happen, basically. Mm-hmm. And then you went on to Godhi Banna. Now, my question to you is, and later from what interviews I read, you seemed a little dismissive about the whole film and the idea. My thing is, can't you take that same boy with commitment issues subject and give it the Hemanth Rao treatment and make it an individualistic kind of film? Or is it that you just don't want to go on your love stories or something like that?
No, in fact, the script in its completed form just before shoot had those. It wasn't just a boy with commitment issues. It had I was quite excited about the film. I still had managed to find my perspective.
Right.
I was still happy with it, but it was forced. It wasn't coming with a deep sense of honesty. It was coming because I got an opportunity and I wanted to encash on the opportunity. I wanted to get my foot into the door and somehow make it into the industry and then do my kind of films. So it was a cop-out in the sense, and it's something that I was not acknowledging back then because I was so starved for opportunities. Like, man, I'm getting a chance to make a film, let me just, like, and the film had all kinds of, you know, stylistic treatments and interesting transitions and interesting scene placements and things that, like, the chemistry between Antoine Dunel and this girl when they're sitting and reading on the bed, that stayed in my head. The kind of emotion that it had invoked is the kind of emotion that I wanted to invoke in something like Love Churmuri as well. But with my own assessment and you know, chop and change of it. But the thing is, it was not something that was coming naturally to me. That is the thing that I had an issue with, which is why I was slightly dismissive. I mean, I would love to do a film like that, provided it comes more organically. So the problem with me is I get involved way too much. I suppose it's the same for any filmmaker, but my sense of attachment with my film is like, it's very difficult for me to, like, you know, just do it just for the heck of it. Even if it is just one frame or one shot, it bothers me a lot. So that it's difficult for me to do it if it's inorganic.
So you could not buy what you did?
Yeah, as in, I was telling myself that it is interesting. It is interesting. But somewhere inside, the subject matter for me was not interesting. The treatment was interesting. The way I was looking to take this film was interesting. But the subject matter for me was like, what is it that I'm trying to say?
Okay.
You know, anybody can make this film. Anybody can do this. But what is my take on it? That was missing.
Can you tell us something about Thenali or project with Rakshit Shetty? Because we got a visual that he's wearing that Sherlock Holmes type of cap, the Deerstalker cap, and, you know, something like that. So, and it's a period film.
Yeah.
So what's it about?
So it's basically, this is idea. Rakshit was coming, driving down to Chennai to watch the remake of Ulidavar Kandante in Tamil. So he had to drive all the way. So he said, come, let's go. So me and Pushkar, the three of us, drove. And on the course of the journey, I had this idea and I just bounced it off to him saying, I have this idea, what do you think? I just, like, both of us got severely excited by the idea. It's a period flick. And Thenali Raman is a story that all of us have grown up on, you know. So the name has no significance or no attachment to the actual Thenali Raman stories. That is set way back in the timeline. This is around the independence era. So it's still too early to speak about it, but it is a serial killer, detective, old school detective type of a story. The baseline is sort of there, but we don't know when it's going to happen because he's busy with his films and, you know, I'm busy with my film. So we don't know when it's going to happen, but both of us are very keen on working with each other.
Which is why I was a little surprised seeing that image so early, because I was like, wow, this, you know, this is, I mean, they barely seem to have announced, I mean, like an idea and the image came out. So the, you know, that was very surprising for me. So
no, the thing is, actually, it wasn't my idea to put the image out. I'm very reserved that way. Like, only when it's good and ready, we'll put out the image. But it was a very, you know, spontaneous thing that Rakshit decided. He was like, let's put out the image today. I was like, okay, you know what, let's just do it for fun. Okay. It was more of that than anything else.
You talked about the True Four films, the Andhadhun films. I think even the, you just described a scene from Stolen Kisses, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, so can you name five films that, apart from the True Four ones, that you actually, as someone who did not go to film school, that you watched and actually learned something from, and what are those things that you learned from these films? It doesn't have to be five exactly, you know, it's a few films.
So I'm a huge fan of Spielberg. So when I saw Jurassic Park, the vision, the scale, it's not the budget or the idea, you know, the ability to take the idea, live with it and materialize it to that amount of perfection where you actually think there are these kind of animals out there, you know. It was so convincing. And the genius of things that he does, where using a water cup, the mirror, it says objects in the mirror appear, you know, those are like strokes of genius, you know. So I've learned a lot while observing his films. I mean, even in terms of camera movement, detailing, it's like an institution by itself. So I would say Spielberg is somebody that I've learned a lot with. I've learned a lot about commercial Indian cinema by watching a lot of Salim Javed films. The whole idea of the angry young man. Although a lot of ideas are borrowed conceptually from here and there, but the way it was Indianized and, you know, the elements that were brought in and the dialogues, the coolness of the dialogues, those are things that I've, you know, it creates, that is what cinema is, you know, when you watch film and the character says something, and it's like when you see something in real life, you see somebody wearing a cool pair of shades, you see it and you're like, oh, that looks really nice, you know, you instantly have this affinity towards it. So to be able to do that in a theater is just, you know, marvelous. So I'd say a lot of Salim Javed films. In down south in Kannada, I've learned a lot from watching Rajkumar, Anant Nag, Shankar Nag films. Again, it was about sort of stepping out from the norm in terms of going away from what is considered to be commercial, but also going out and trying to narrate stories like Accident or, you know, a lot of such films, Kavaludaari and so on and so forth. So I've learned a lot from these kind of films. And of course, my favorite bunch of films are films from the Middle East, where they don't use music, there's no manipulation with music. It's just, you know, it's just storytelling, camera and actors coming together and performing. I think for me, it's the truest, purest form of filmmaking, because music is a crutch in the sense that the moment you put a very powerful tune, a weak scene can also get elevated.
Yeah.
They don't do that. Like when I saw Children of Heaven, when I saw Separation, I mean, there is some Song of Sparrows and so on and so forth. They don't use music at all. And to be still able to invoke those kind of emotions, that is just like ballsy, you know, more than anything else. I can't even imagine making a film without music. So yeah, quite varied in that sense.
Finally, when you get to Kavaludaari, which would you recommend that we watch certain films to kind of brush up on the background necessary for the film, or do you just say, okay, go see it with a fresh eye?
The thing is, I'm very, when I make a film, for me, the reference point is I identify with a certain emotion when I have seen a particular film. Like for example, when I was making Godhi Banna, the reference point for me is Good Will Hunting. When I saw Good Will Hunting, the emotion that I felt, that film stayed with me for 2-3 days. I was not able to get it out of my system, you know. It made me feel very emotional, it made me feel vulnerable, it made me feel, you know, there was a sense of pain. So I wanted to create the same experience of what I went through. So I usually have one such reference point where I keep telling people around that if people feel this way after watching a film that I made, it'll be great, you know. So there is a film like that which I'll tell you after Kavaludaari.
You mentioned Touch of Evil earlier.
No, this is
something else.
Something else.
So we'll watch the film and decide if we felt the same thing. All the best, Hemant.
Thank you so much. Pleasure. Hi, my name is Hemanth Rao. For more such videos, please subscribe to Film Companion South.